So next talk is by David Eichler. Unfortunately, he is unable to be here. So he'll be giving his Skype talk. And the title of the talk is A New Explanation for the Energy Dependence of the Secondary to Primary Ratio in Cosmic Rays.
So I'm going to talk about cosmic rays and the connection to super bubbles.
David, at the time limit, we'll just interrupt you. We'll interrupt you 5 minutes before the talk, when the talk is going to end, okay?
And then okay.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, the story begins with the well-known observation that the secondary to primary ratio in cosmic rays decreases with energy. For example, the bulk ratio decreases with energy. Boron is made by collisions of carbon nuclei with other, and the one proton by itself becomes boron. The conventional explanation is that the escape rate from the galaxy, and therefore the grammage traversed by the cosmic ray, is energy dependent. So low energy cosmic rays go through more grammage than high energy cosmic rays. And that's always been the explanation, and that is attributed to the fact that high energy cosmic rays have a larger diffusion coefficient, so they should diffuse out of the galaxy faster. But then there appeared this result from AMSO2 that the expected boron to carbon ratio, the expected anti-proton ratio, anti-protons are also the result of cosmic ray collisions. It should decrease between 10 and 100 GeV, but it's observed not to decrease. And why doesn't it decrease? One explanation that we proposed was that dark matter decays into antiproton. It has very hard spectrum indicated by this solid line. And when you add it to the antiprotons from cosmic ray collision, you get something that looks flat. But there's other people said, well, it's within the uncertainties. My view is yes, there are uncertainties in how much boron and how many secondaries you expect. There are always uncertainties in astrophysics. But if something is supposed to decrease with energy and it doesn't decrease with energy, then in my opinion, that's not within the uncertainties. So the problem is real. If you invoke dark matter decay, you can barely squeeze within the limits imposed by the diffuse gamma ray background, indicated by this pink shading. You're right at the top here of the pink shading, the limits are just going to get better with time. These are future limits, and they will improve with as CTA becomes developed. But I'm not ready to wait that long. I'm not sure that dark matter decay is the answer, and consider it a different explanation for the constant antiproton to proton ratio: superbubbles. The idea is, suppose that the galactic cosmic ray spectrum, which is steeper than the theoretical production spectrum for shock acceleration, usually that extra steepness is attributed to the energy-dependent escape, which means the residence time of cosmic rays in the galaxy is energy-dependent, and that steepens the spectrum relative to the production spectrum. But suppose that's not the reason. Suppose it's steeper because it is the composite, the spectrum is the composite of many different spectra, each of which has its own high energy cutoff. In other words, the maximum energy to which any given shock can accelerate cosmic rays varies with energy. And that means that, for example, if you have four different regions, each one giving a flat spectrum but with a different high energy cutoff, it means when you sum those different spectra, you're going to get something steeper than any of the individual spectra. Okay, now suppose further that the ground rays traversed by cosmic rays with the low Emax is greater than traversed by cosmic rays with the high Emax. In that case, secondary such as boron will be even steeper than the sum primaries, which in turn are steeper than the individual primary spectra. Now, that's a very simple explanation, but it makes a very simple prediction. It says that different sources have different grammages, and that means that the grammage traversed depends on the source. In other words, most of the grammage is traversed near the source, not in the interstellar medium after the cosmic ray has left the source. Now, if most cosmic ray collisions are made close to the source before they diffuse away, then most gamma rays from neutral pions should be from localized sources, rather than diffuse emission from the disk at large. So, is it, or are they? What about the gamma rays? So, Katie, Alsha, and I, we just found that the answer is yes. Most gamma rays come from discrete sources. Here, in the black squares show the diffuse gamma ray emission. The gray stars show the emission from localized sources, all supernova remnants, summed in stack. You see that it's greater than the diffuse emission, and considerably greater. But not only that, this diffuse emission probably includes many point sources that are too far for us to see. And if we could resolve individual sources, we would find that that their total was greater than this, and that the remaining diffuse emission was less than this. So really, most of the gamma ray emission from pion decay from our galaxy is from localized sources, and that means most cosmic ray collisions are happening in localized sources. Now, here I just show that more than half the point sources are expected to be more than 8.5 kiloparsecs from the sun, which is the distance between the sun and the center of the galaxy. More than half the sources should be in the blue region. But here are the distances to the sources that we can resolve. Only 4 of 19 are more distant than 8.5 kiloparsecs. So we can assume that there are a lot more point sources on the other side of the galaxy that we are not yet resolving yet. So the answer is yes, most hadronic gamma rays, and therefore most cosmic ray collisions, occur close to the birthplace of the cosmic rays as opposed to the interstellar medium at large. And therefore, most secondaries are made also close to the birthplace of the cosmic ray. Now, there's another bit of evidence that a beautiful argument points to that same conclusion. The boron to carbon ratio in interstellar gas and in stellar photosphere seems to be independent of the age of the galaxy. The implication is that boron is made from freshly made carbon. If the boron had been produced in the interstellar medium by carbon that is already mixed up with the interstellar medium, the carbon abundance would grow linearly with time, proportional to the number of stars that have exploded and dumped carbon in. But the boron abundance, which is the time derivative, is proportional to the carbon abundance. The boron abundance would grow quadratically with time. Where's my pointer? But that's not the case. The boron seems to be to grow linearly with time, just as the carbon, and that means that it's made from the carbon before the carbon can disperse, its place of birth. So the implications are enormous. It means not only do cosmic rays make lots of collisions near their source, but they exit the galaxy before making an equal number in the interstellar medium at large. To me, this is direct evidence for a super bubble wind or something very similar, because you have to blow the cosmic rays out mostly before they even mix with the galaxy at large. Now, if they're blown out by a wind, why would there be energy dependence in the escape rate? The answer to that question is, maybe there isn't energy dependence in the escape rate. Maybe the secondary to primary ratio has a different explanation, namely the one that I just gave. So, so the alternative explanation implies a wind, and the wind implies that there needs to be an alternative explanation, that they're each very consistent with the other. Now, in order for the antiproton to proton ratio to be constant with energy beyond 100 GeV, the secondary to primary ratio has to not decrease well beyond this energy. And that's another prediction of the model that the boron to carbon ratio will flatten out as you go to energies not yet achieved in the boron observations. Now, there's both a theoretical and observational reason to suspect that this is going to happen. First of all, theoretically, why should the correlation between Ramage and maximum energy, why should there be an anti-correlation below a certain energy, but then it should suddenly stop above a certain energy? Why would that happen? There's a theoretical reason why it would happen. Because in order for shock acceleration to work, the maximum energy, in order for shock acceleration to work, you need alpha emitters. You need alpha waves, and that means the alpha waves have to grow faster than their band. Anything that you grow, the growth rate has to be greater than the shrinkage rate. Now, when is the growth rate of alpha waves faster than the damping rate? First of all, the damping of alpha waves is generally due to friction between ions and neutrals. Now, here there's a very neat little piece of physics. If the wave period is shorter than the ion-neutral coupling time, the ions and neutrons are decoupled in the wave oscillation, and the wave dissipation is proportional to the collision rate. The faster ions and neutrals collide with each other, the faster the wave bends. But when the wave period is longer than the ion-neutral coupling time, then the ion and neutrals oscillate together, coupled, and a faster collision rate reduces the friction rather than increasing it, because it keeps them better coupled, and then there's less friction between them. So what is that critical wave period? That the wave period is proportional to the energy of the cosmic rays, right? Because a longer wavelength means a higher energy cosmic ray, because the wavelength is basically equal to the gyro resonance. It's the distance a cosmic ray traveled in one gyro radius. And that's proportional to the energy. Now, I'm not going to go through the mathematics, but if you calculate what that energy is, you find that in order for the wave frequency to be greater than the ion-neutral coupling time, the energy has to be less than 70 GeV, the energy of the cosmic ray times a bunch of things that depend their order unity, etc. except for the ion energy, usually in any stellar medium, the ion density is less than 1 per cubic centimeter, because if you're in the hot phase, it's the higher temperature means that the same pressure implies lower density. And if you're in the warm phase, you have about 1 cubic centimeter of density, but most of it is in neutrals. So the ion density is usually less than this, and the minus 3 has power. The maximum energy will typically be between 70 and GeV and a few hundred keV. This below this energy, ion neutral collisions damp the alpha waves that make the shock acceleration work. Above this energy, ion neutral collisions do not damp the alpha waves. Now, if they do damp the alpha waves, then the ion neutral damping sets an upper limit on the maximum energy that the cosmic rays can attain. This maximum energy is 10 to the 19th eV, roughly, times the shock velocity over C to the third power. So it's highly sensitive to the shock velocity. And the shock velocity, in turn, is very sensitive to the age of the supernova remnant. The maximum energy as to which the shock can accelerate cosmic rays can be anywhere from 10 GeV to 300 GeV, depending on the expansion velocity of the supernova remnant. And the maximum energy for any given, the maximum energy at which any given supernova remnant accelerates cosmic rays, it should drop 3 orders of magnitude for every order of magnitude drop in the shock velocity itself. So, for example, if the shock velocity in the course of supernova remnant drops from 3,000 kilometers per second to 300 kilometers per second, then the high energy cutoff should drop by 3 orders of magnitude. And here you see that's exactly what is observed. Young cosmic rays, young supernova remnants rather, have gamma ray spectra that seem to have a high energy cutoff of about, a few times 10 to the 12 EV, maybe 10 EV. That means the primary cosmic rays have an energy of like 10 to the 14th EV. So this is close to the theoretical limit. But the older cosmic rays with the slower shock velocity have much lower high energy cutoffs. The oldest ones literally 3 orders of magnitude or more below the high energy cutoffs for the younger supernova remnant. But notice also that most of the gamma rays, and in fact most of the energy in gamma rays, comes from the more elderly, shall we say, supernova remnants, simply because they have more time and they sweep up more volume. And they have the last say. The young supernova remnants produce primary protons above 10 to the 14 GeV. The iron nuclei can be even 26 times more energetic. And this is consistent with the classical energy limit on shock absorber cosmic rays in supernova. But in old supernova remnants, the maximum cutoff is typically well below a TeV, almost certainly lowered by ion neutral collisions, and observations indicate that more secondaries are produced there than in young supernova remnants. So we have to take these very modest high energy cutoffs seriously in calculating the cosmic ray spectra, especially for secondaries. Now, if the Ramage Emax anti-correlation does not extend beyond some high energy, then the decrease of the energy of more of the carbon should flatten out at energies beyond the energy where Emax is limited by high initial collision. It's a little complicated to say, but basically boron and antiprotons and gamma rays are all secondary particles. They all go together. They should all provide clues about each other. So the question is, if you're going to make this prediction that boron to carbon flattens out above some energy, should this not apply to gamma rays too? Well, does it? The answer is yes, it does. Here you see, I'm going back to these gamma ray spectra I showed before, you see that the gamma ray spectrum, both in the diffuse component and in the stacked discrete heat source component, it flattens out. For primary energies that are of order 10 to 100 GeV, it's steeper, but then it flattens out to something that is no steeper than the primary cosmic ray spectrum. And the same here, I'll show it here. Last night, Katie computed these slopes from her data. In all of these spectra, the gamma rays are as flat as the and the primary cosmic rays are in our galaxy, which shows that the escape rate, it shows that the escape rate is not energy dependent, and to the extent that it is, it stops being energy dependent at sufficiently high energy. Note that that this green curve here, which is the, should reflect the cosmic ray spectra in individual sources, it's as flat as we expect shock, the production spectrum of shock acceleration to be, indicating that even at these high energies, all of the cosmic rays produced went through the same amount of matter, even in the source. So my conclusions are the following. The first conclusion is that most secondaries are made near the cosmic ray acceleration site, strongly supporting the hypothesis of cosmic ray escape by convection from superbubbles, or at least from wherever their acceleration sites are. Second conclusion is the strong dependence of high energy cutoff with supernova remnant age supports the hypothesis that this high energy cutoff is determined by ion neutral damping in not so young supernova remnants. Third, is above 100 GeV, the secondary to primary ratio, as hinted by gamma ray emission, seems to be independent of energy, and this is indicative of energy independent gramage consistent with antiproton data. And four, superbubble dynamics, ionization traction, density, and so forth, the thing that you guys calculate, these things are inscribed in cosmic ray spectrum. So I suggest to anybody writing papers and modeling superbubbles, they should calculate, they should put in test particles, they should put in test cosmic rays and see how much remnant these cosmic rays go through. You will get very, very significant observational limits from cosmic ray data on your superbubble dynamics. And I see it's a little bit off my screen here, but there's one mystery. In spite of the fact that I'm trying to present you with a new paradigm, I have to admit there are lots of mysteries about cosmic ray spectrum that still remain. And with that, I will conclude. Thank you.
I think we can ask him questions if someone wants to ask him, maybe he can.
Can you see me now?
Yeah, we can see you. So we'll try the microphone and let's see if you can hear the questions. Okay?
Okay.
Or you can moderate it.
I think it's better if you can answer something. So see if you can hear the question. Roland Crockett has a question.
Thank you for your talk, David. So, one question, can this theory accommodate the positron spectrum, cosmic ray positron spectrum hardening?
Can you hear the question, David?
Yes, I think they probably can. If you say that positrons are secondary particles, the reason I don't talk about positrons as much as antiprotons is that positrons never pose that much of an embarrassment because they can come from pulsars. You know, one nearby pulsar solves the positron problem, as well as, dark matter decay and all the hundreds of papers written on dark matter decay. But yes, if those antiprotons, if those positrons are just come from cosmic ray collisions, then yes, it explains them too.
Right, so there is a paper by Paolo Lippari where he tries to explain both the antiprotons and the positrons as secondaries, I think, because the spectra are consistent.
Yes, well, it's well known that the antiprotons and the positrons, they both have flat ratios relative to the primaries, and that's more or less what we expect here. So yes, I agree that they're both consistent with each other. I'm just saying that if they had not been consistent, there would have been a lot of excuses. Why not? But now it appears that we don't even have to use the excuses.
Any other questions?
So, David, it's Roland Crocker again. I have another question.
Yes.
So, does your theory mean anything for the cosmic ray pressure in the disk? I mean, dynamically, it seems that cosmic ray pressure is important for establishing a hydrostatic equilibrium of the galactic disk. Does your theory mean that there's actually less cosmic ray pressure?
There's certainly less cosmic ray pressure than if the cosmic rays never escape. I think that it's a complicated question because there's something called Parker instability, which says that even if you didn't have supernova blowing out holes in the galactic disk, the cosmic rays would still escape through some regions more than others due to the buoyancy of the magnetic field lines, especially when inflated by cosmic rays. So there was always that problem of the fact that the disk is horribly leaky. It's like trying to blow up a balloon with holes in it. The pressure inside the balloon will always be less than there were no holes.
David, Biman here. So do you think then the diffusion coefficient doesn't have to be energy dependent? I mean, as if you thought?
No, I didn't say that. What I really said was that the escape from the galaxy is energy independent. The diffusion coefficient is allowed to be energy dependent as long as the cosmic ray escape is not governed by diffusion. For example, if a superbubble wind blows the cosmic rays out of the galaxy and they're ejected out, the diffusion coefficient could be energy dependent, but it wouldn't matter because the cosmic rays are not escaping by diffusion, they're escaping by advection.
Yeah, okay.
David, this is Pratik. You had these estimates for fluxes and so on, and you had this Ni, which was...
Sorry, what? I missed the word. I have the estimates of what?
You had the estimated of fluxes and so on for your cosmic rays, and this you were scaling the number density, and it was scaled to one particle per centimeter cube. And you said that the super bubble modeler should, you know, get this number. I want to understand what do you mean by that number?
I was pointing to the ion density. Yeah, I was pointing to Ni.
Yes.
I'm just trying to find that.
And you said that.
It's on one of these slides here. But yes, it seems to me that in a model of super Ni varies. Here it is. Ni varies. I would expect considerable variation of Ni within the super bubble.
Because
you have photoionization and you have recombination, you have dense regions and you have hot, tenuous regions. And that's why it's very hard to estimate Ni other than numerically.
So this Ni is what? Is it the density within the bubble, in the shell, or in the disk? In which the super bubble is going off?
It's the ion density upstream of the forward shock of the supernova.
So if it is going off inside a CGM type of environment, Ni of 1 is actually very high. What do you have to say about that?
Please repeat.
So Ni of 1 seems very high to me.
It is. It seems high to me too. That's why I said Ni over 1 per cubic centimeter is probably a small number. Maybe it's a tenth or, you know, maybe even 1.01. I don't know.
Okay.
And take it to the minus 3/2 power, it gives you something, that's greater than 1. Logically a lot greater than 1.
Okay.
So the maximum energy, the divide energy between alpha waves coupled to neutrals and alpha waves decoupled from neutrals, that dividing energy is probably at least 70 GeV, but probably more because of this Ni minus 3/2 factor.
Okay, David, so I think there are no more questions. Thank you for your talk, and I wish you could made it to the conference physically. That's much better always than this Skype talk. So maybe
I wish too, but
yeah.
If you leave your Skype on in the afternoon, I'll be happy to listen.
Yeah, that's actually quite a little difficult to set it up in this.
Okay.
Okay, David.
Right.
Bye then.
I'll see you on YouTube. Thanks.
Yes. Bye.
Bye.